Hey everybody, welcome back to the To Be Like Christ Bible study of the Gospel of Luke. We just started chapter 2 in our last study. Remember, if you haven't already, grab the notes either offline or on Amazon.com if you want a hard copy like I have here, and you can follow along with exactly what I'm reading and save all this for your reference later. Make your own notes. Links to that stuff is down in the description below, as well as some other links. Let's remember where we were. So in the very beginning, well, at the very end of chapter 1, Zechariah and Elizabeth had their son, John the Baptist. And then, as we open up chapter 2, the Roman government decided that it was a good idea to demand that everyone go back to their hometowns to be registered. This is for tax purposes. So during the time that Quirinius was the governor of Syria, remember we talked about him in the last video. Okay, so everyone's kind of on their way to participate in this registration, and that's where we pick up here in verses 4 through 7. We're going to talk about the birth of Jesus. Verse 4. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David, to be registered with Mary his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. And so in order to complete this registration and to do what the government told them to do, they had to go back to the city of their lineage. And Joseph here, who is Mary's betrothed husband, you notice, as we mentioned in a previous study, they're not married yet, still in this betrothal phase. And Mary is about to have this son who was miraculously conceived inside her by God. Okay, so they're traveling back to Bethlehem. That was Joseph's city of the lineage because he was of the household of David. Bethlehem is known as the city of David. And the reason it's known as the city of David is because that was David's hometown. David was a king who lived about 1,000 years before Jesus, and he was a very significant character in Israelite history or Jewish history. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 4, you can read about where the prophet Samuel, or the judge Samuel, went to the town of Bethlehem to anoint Jesse's youngest son David to be the king over Israel. Saul was the king at the time, but he wasn't a very good king. So God selected David, who was the youngest of all of his brothers. No one expected him to become king, but that's the way that God wanted it done. Okay, so anyway, Joseph was from the lineage of David. He had to go back to the city of his lineage. He goes to Bethlehem to be registered. You can read about Joseph's family line in chapter 3, which we will get to in not too long. You can read about David specifically in chapter 3, verse 31. So Mary was very pregnant, apparently, when her and her betrothed set off on this journey. This is approximately 90 miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem. There's a map in your notes. Can you imagine being close to 9 months pregnant and having to ride some animal, a colt or a donkey or whatever, 90 miles through the hill through, you know, down through some somewhat barren land, right? Or any terrain on a donkey for 90 miles would be quite an experience. 90 miles, 9 months pregnant. Yeah, that might be another thing. The Romans must not have given the Jews very much flexibility in when they were supposed to show up to be registered, because otherwise you would think that Joseph would have just stayed in Nazareth until the baby was born and maybe come afterwards. But they went, even though she was very close to her time of giving birth. And you think about that, no doubt the time and the place and the requirements of this registration were all providentially arranged by God. You know, the Messiah had to be born in a particular city. He had to be born in Bethlehem because it was prophesied that he would be. Okay, so God has to select his mother and father, earthly mother and father, for this Messiah to be born, and then he has to get them in Bethlehem at the exact time he needs them there in order for Jesus to be born. So all of this was arranged, and I guess, you know, this came from the very top of the Roman Empire, from Augustus Caesar. He was the one who ordered the census, and so it really shows God's sovereignty and providential organization of all of the nations, even these nations who don't necessarily respect him or know him. The Roman government would have decreed this census because they thought that it was in the best interest of their empire. You know, got to keep up with who's here and how much stuff they have and how much we're allowed to tax them every year. So they thought it was in their interest. And it's interesting though to see that God was doing this because it was in his interests. He was establishing a kingdom that would outlast the Roman Empire. And he organized this in order to begin for his king, right? The king of the kingdom of heaven to be born and to be sit on the throne of a kingdom that would never be destroyed. And think about that in terms of application. I think there's quite a bit of application that we can take from that, and a lot of different ways that we can, it applies to a lot of different areas of our lives. But you know, imagine all the people who weren't Mary and Joseph, just regular Jews, even beyond the Jewish nation, all the people who were affected by this registration. Yeah, they probably just thought, you know, oh man, this is another government restriction or a government rule or mandate or whatever that we have to follow. This is such an inconvenience. You know, I got to make a trip and I got to organize this and all for the reason of paying taxes. Like, who likes taxes? Nobody likes taxes. So, yeah, this would have just been something else the mundane citizen would have, or something else that the citizen would have had to deal with that just felt like the mundane workings of government. And they were probably annoyed with it, just like we in the modern world are often annoyed with things that the government makes us do and the way that they take our money and use our money. And anyway, out of the probably millions of people who were affected by this registration, probably 99, if not more than 99% of them never had any clue how God used this to bring a savior into the world in Bethlehem. Bethlehem was kind of a nowhere. It just wasn't a super significant place in world events, especially not in the Roman Empire. And God did this thing almost in secret here through the workings of this government mandate, and almost everyone was oblivious to it. And they would remain, you know, a few more people would understand what God was doing 30 years later when Jesus began his ministry. But it was largely done under the nose of and out of the sight of the vast, vast majority of people. And I think there's a lot of application for that in the sense that we often feel like God isn't doing anything, that he's not active, that he's not working, because we can't see it. You know, maybe we don't see anything big going on. Maybe we are, you know, frustrated that God isn't taking bigger action sooner, right? We can't see the way that all the cogs fit in the you know, to make the machine of God's providence run. We don't see the intricate ways in which he works in sometimes the smallest places of the world, in order to bring about exactly what he wants, and how those little tiny small things can have a world-changing impact. And yet I think one of the lessons that we can take away from this is that God was and he is still working in secret for our good, even when we are clueless to it. I don't think there's any reason to believe that God worked this way in the Bible times and he doesn't work this way currently. No doubt, you think about just the pandemic. We're all under certain government mandates, and for a lot of us, they're just like giant inconveniences. We think, I'm sick of the government and the things that they come up with, and tired of following all these rules. Just another pain in my side for the mundane goings on of life. And we might think of it that way, but who knows what God has done or will do through all of just this one singular event. Right? What he could have done something, I don't know, somewhere in Africa, right? That's going to change the world in 100 years. We don't know, and probably we're never going to know. But just because we don't know about it doesn't mean that God's not doing it. And it's really arrogant to think that just because I'm not aware of the way that God works that I then have the ability to accuse him of not doing anything. Right? It's super arrogant to accuse God of not doing anything about the problems of the world, or you know, to fix what's wrong, when we're aware of 0.00000001 events that go on in the world. Right? And God's aware of them all and is orchestrating them all, and he's working in ways that just we're just going to be totally oblivious to. And we just need to sit back and say, you know, I don't know what God's plan is. I don't know where he's working. I don't know how he's working. I can't even figure that out in my own life sometimes, much less the life of 7 billion other people and all the world governments and cultures and organizations, right? God's at work somewhere in there. Just trust that he is. And then here's a scene where nobody knew, and yet God was at work. So take this and let it be a lesson to us that God is very active and can be very active even when we don't know all the details. So when Mary and Joseph arrived in Bethlehem, their son was ready to make his appearance. And Luke doesn't exactly tell us where Jesus was born, which is interesting. He only tells us that after Jesus, or after Mary and Joseph's son was born, who they named Jesus, Luke only tells us where he was laid, and it says that he was laid in a manger. And a manger is like a feeding or a watering trough for animals. I have a hand-drawn manger there from yours truly in the notes if you want to see that. If you're grew up on a farm or anywhere around animals, you're already going to know what that is. But now, why would a newborn or a couple put their newborn baby in a manger? Well, Luke tells us that there wasn't any room in the inn at the time, so they had to go somewhere else, and this baby was delivered somewhere else. And it doesn't tell us exactly where, but this seems like maybe it was a stable or a barn somewhere where the animals ate. Around Christmas time, you always see, you know, the little hut made out of wood, looks like a little tiny house, and all the animals are surrounding the manger looking at Jesus. It might have been something like that, or it might have been something completely different. We just don't have the details on it. But what we know is that there wasn't any room left in the inn, and so they had to take this other option. It's not really surprising that the lodging places would have been all full, because there were probably tons and tons of people traveling for this census, right? And being 9 months pregnant, Mary and Joseph likely would have traveled a little bit slower than everybody else, since they might have showed up in town close to last, and everyone had already booked up all the places to stay. So Mary and Joseph then wrapped their son in swaddling clothing. And for the longest time, I thought swaddling clothing was like some kind of special material, like some kind of cloth. And I don't think that it is. It's actually a technique for wrapping the child up. So I don't have any children. That's why I didn't know this. But when you swaddle a baby, you wrap up its arms and its legs into basically a little baby cocoon so that it can't move, or so that its movement is restricted. And this is still practiced in the world in some places. There's some debate about whether or not it's a good thing to do or not. And some people say that it helps the baby sleep and kind of gradually acclimate to its environment a little bit, makes the acclimation process a little bit easier because, you know, in the womb, a baby's pretty restricted. It can't move around a lot, can't flail its arms. And so when it comes out of the mother and you wrap it up in these clothes, it helps it just to make the transition a little bit easier. And then other people say it's got health benefits. Some people say it keeps them from scratching or from injuring themselves, or, you know, whatever, something like that. Although babies seem to be pretty resilient. I don't know that much about babies, but they seem like they're pretty tough. Anyway, we'll discuss swaddling clothing a little bit more as we look at the next couple of verses, verses 8 through 12. But it's interesting, isn't it, that God could organize world events to have his son born in the particular town at the particular place that matched all the prophecies of the Old Testament, and yet he didn't save them any space at the inn. And No doubt that was intentional. It was supposed to be that way. It wasn't like God was like, oh, you know what? I forgot about that. Of course he did that. And why might Jesus have been born in a barn or a stable or wherever this was? Well, it could have been because God was nice to the innkeeper and didn't want to make him clean up that mess, because I've heard childbirth isn't the cleanest process, but probably, it's probably not the case. It probably has something more to do with communicating what kind of Messiah this was going to be. God's man, his king, his chosen, his anointed one. A lot of people had ideas about who he would be. This great ruler, who probably embodied a lot of the characteristics that they saw in their earthly kings. But God was like, no. That's not what I'm doing here. Jesus was born in a very humble place with the animals. He was born to humble parents of no real reputation or money. And then he was born in a humble town. And all of that is pretty incredible. It shows us that God has no intention of meeting our expectations, of working the way that men usually work, having people born into greatness, the way that men typically think great men are born. There's none of that. He begins the gospel, he begins the story of the salvation of mankind with a statement that what you expected isn't what's coming. And so you better get ready to toss all of your expectations out the window, because this savior, Messiah figure, he's going to be something different. So that's what we'll discover as we go throughout the Gospel of Luke. So thanks everybody for hanging out today and studying with me. In the next video, we will do verses 8 through probably through 14. So I will see you guys tomorrow.